Job chapter 13. I'm going to read probably one of the most profound statements in the Bible. And that's, and you know, you may have something different, but that's, in my opinion, that's to me one of the most profound statements in the Bible. Job chapter 13 and verse 15. Though he slay me, yet will I trust him. Though he slay me. I ponder over that thought all week long. Though he slay me. And that, when we think about God, that's not a thought we want to have. Now, you have to understand, in Job's case, this wasn't just some kind of thing he was going through, or I'm having a little trouble with something. This, he thought he was going to die. And by all means, he should have died. By all rights, he should have died. But to come up with this statement, there will be moments in the book of Job, and Job has his moments of, but the thing that got Job the most is he said, I'm innocent. And the Bible proves he was innocent. Even God himself speaks that very idea when he's talking to the enemy about Job is blameless and upright, eschews evil, fears God. God was saying the guy's completely innocent. And that's the thing that Job maintained the whole time and through this. And we talk about integrity. Integrity is innocence. He knew he was innocent. But yet God allowed the enemy to do this. And that's not something that we really think have, you know, we were like, okay, Lord, you know, we can skip the book of Job here. We all know, let's move on. But to say this, though he slay me, yet will I trust him. Amen. Do we fully grasp the power of trust? You know, people say it all the time. Oh, yeah, you can trust me, or you can trust him, or you can trust this, you can trust that. But when you really talk about trust is not something that we just say. Trust is something we have to give. And he says, though he slay me, yet will I trust him. Let's pray. Father, I love you today. Thank you for the power of God that we feel in this place. Thank you, Lord, that you have visited us. With your presence, Lord, as we begin to worship you, you have visited us. And Lord, you are here now. And I thank you for being. I feel your presence. Lord, as we bring this topic to them today, God, as we minister this word to them, Lord, I pray that the effect that you want would happen, that we would trust you regardless. Trust you in spite of. Trust you no matter what. Lord, help us to take this to our heart and to apply it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you. You can be seated today. None of us know when the test is going to come. None of us ever know beforehand what the test will be or what is going to happen during the test. And many times we may not even understand what the test is even all about. All we know is we're going to be tested. And sometimes the test you go through will be unlike anything you've ever gone through in your life before. A test so odd, a test so troubling and unbelievable and difficult that you may even reach a point in the test where you look and say, I have no hope. I have no hope. Life is full of tests. Trials plague both, the Bible says, the believer and the unbeliever. And when bad things happen to bad people, we shake our head like, yep, I can understand that. But when it happens to us, the first reaction is, why is God doing this to me? Why is God being so unfair? Now, the Bible has a very different view on testing. You know, I remember when I was a kid in school, and the teacher would announce the day before there was a test. The next day, man, we all fell apart, and, you know, it was terrible and horrible, and we want to quit school. But in the Bible doesn't look at tests in that manner. The Bible doesn't look at tests from the view of this is something that is that's really going to mess up the rest of your life. The Bible looks at a test as something as a cause of joy. We talked about it last week. Count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptations. In other words, count it all joy when you go through tests and trials. But isn't it hard to see it that way? today. I mean, how many people get up in church and they run and shout and scream all over the building, and somebody says, "Man, you sure are happy." And they'll say, "Yeah, I'm really being beat down by hell today, and it feels great." Nobody says that. So when you go through these tests, is it the inconvenience of life being disrupted? Or maybe there's a certain part of us or a certain aspect of our spirit that understands that maybe something deeper and more powerful is at work here. Do we understand that when we go through these tests, it's not just God saying, "Hey, I think you need a little trouble to get you to pray a little more." Or maybe something God is working inside of you. Maybe something in your life is about to be birthed. Or maybe something is about to break through that yet we don't understand quite what's going on. My prayer is, God, don't let me mess this thing up. Whatever it is you're doing, whatever it is you've got going on in my life, God, don't let me mess it up by having the wrong attitude. Because I want you to understand, when our life is being tested, it's not just God playing with our emotions. It's not God just looking down saying, "I'm bigger than all of you, so I can just do whatever I want with you." No, God is doing something powerful, because these tests can be either a make it or break it moment. And I want it to be a make it moment. So if we face these tests that we're dealing with as feelings as our guide, we're only going to wind up being discouraged and possibly even get to the point where we give up. Job's wife, when you read the things, there's only two times in the book of Job she is mentioned. And when you read these two things, neither one are positive. Job's wife allowed her feelings to lead her in what was taking place in her life at the moment. And I can understand. She just lost all of her children. She just lost her security, her wealth, everything that she had, her standing in the community of being such a woman of such a great man. She lost every bit of that. And people who have given up are only going to try to encourage you to give up as well. Because they're going to look and say, "If there's no hope for me, how could there be any hope for you?" But the thing is, feelings should never get in the way of faith. And feelings should never be the thing that decides our future. Sure, you've got to have faith in God. You can't let your feelings get in the way of the work that God is doing in your life. You've got to have faith in God. Not only faith, but a spirit of gratitude to go with it. A spirit of gratitude. Job said to his wife, after she looked at him and makes this horrific statement, "Why don't you just curse God and die?" Job looked at her and said, "Will we not only accept good at God's hand and not only disaster and adversity?" He said, "Honey, you may not understand what's happening right now, but he's been too good to me for me to give up." Hallelujah. Has he been good to you, church? Has he blessed you? Has he brought you through? How many of you got your mind made up here today? It is worth serving God no matter what I got to go through. Amen. Job was diseased and depleted, but yet he found something to be grateful for. See, this is when you know your faith is strong, when you can lose everything in the world, but yet you can look and say, "I have not lost everything, because I still have God. And if I've got Him, I've got everything." Hallelujah. He said, God gives and God takes. He said, but blessed be the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. You see, real worship comes at a price, and God will never overlook the sacrifice of what you have to give up. He'll never overlook it. He said, the Lord gave and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. You know what is amazing about God? Circumstances do not define nor determine His goodness. It doesn't matter if I'm going through a bad day. It doesn't change the fact He's still good. It's not blessings that define how good God is. It's His faithfulness that define how good He is. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. You can trust Him in everything you go through. You can trust Him with everything you put in His hands. You can trust Him with your life. You can trust Him in the good and the bad and the ugly. You can trust Him when it doesn't make any sense. You can trust Him when it hurts. You can trust Him when He doesn't give you the answer you're looking for. You've got to trust Him. And the Bible said, lean not on your own understanding, but in all your ways acknowledge Him. You've got to learn how to trust God and trust His goodness and trust His faithfulness, that wherever you are and whatever you go through, God will always be the same. Amen. You can trust Him. You can trust Him. Trust is a very powerful word. Trust is not a word that I think we should just throw around in any situation to make something sound good or to make you look good. Trust is a very powerful word. And trust is also a precious thing to give to someone. You know, I was studying this week, I come across some varied meanings of the word trust. And I thought about Chris and Heather when I come across this one. And I think it probably ranks up there among one of the most powerful descriptions of trust. And it's a foster parent. I thought that was interesting. You know, when you take a child and you place that child in the care of people they do not know. Neither the child knows them, neither they know the child. Both parties have to be willing to take that risk of not knowing personalities, not knowing character or any other thing about each other, to look and say, let's work together. It's the same thing with God. To say that we know everything about God, we don't. How many times have we been in a situation where God did not give any explanation about what was taking place, but we just said, you know what, you're God, and I trust you. I don't know where I'm going sometimes. I don't know which direction. All I know is I'm walking by faith. But God, I trust you. I've got a sickness. I'm believing for a miracle. The numbers are looking worse, but God, I trust you. I trust you. It is the biggest leap of faith I think that you can take. The biggest thing you can do is to trust God. Do you understand that in this book called Job, God took a risk when he allowed the enemy to test Job? God took a risk. You know why? Because God placed his entire reputation on the actions of one man. That's amazing. That's one of those things. It's like, Lord, thank you that I was not Job, because I surely would have really let you down. This would not have been good. I mean, what trust for God to place in one man? But you know what it shows me? It just shows how powerful trust is. That God can look at Satan and say, do your worst to that guy. And all this stuff you said he would do, he won't do. That shows me trust is greater than the enemy. God placed so much trust in how Job would respond to the test. And you know something? God was right. Why would God do that? Why would God, of all the people in the earth, say, oh, come here, Satan. See him? My Lord, don't you do that. You see him? Give him your best shot. And poor Job doesn't even know none of it's going on. He's just down there, going about doing whatever. And boom, the hammer drops. Everything in his life is shattered in a moment. And you know how the devil sat back and grinned as he watched all this take place. And then all of a sudden, Job does the unthinkable. He falls on his knees and he lifts his hands to heaven and he says, God, you give and you take, but I bless your name. Hallelujah. Amen. Do you understand that God believed in him? Do you know that God believes in you? Why do you think the devil's done some of the stuff to you he's done? And God's allowed testing to come into your life because God looks at you and says, I believe in you. I believe in you. I believe in what I stand for. I believe in the spirit I gave you that I planted in you. I believe in the call that I placed on your life. That's why every day I get up, I say, devil, I'm here to prove you a liar. I know you're a liar, but I'm here to prove every day to you that you're a liar. Because God trusts in me, and I'm not going to let God down. How about you got your mind made up here today? Though he slay me, yet will I trust him. I'm going to go to my grave praising the name of God. Amen. Hallelujah. See, we have to adopt the mindset that everything we have is His to begin with. As much as I love my children and my grandchildren and my wife, I realize that everything that I have in life has only been borrowed from God. It's not mine to begin with. It's all His. Because there's something about if you take away every bit of that, God forbid, everything in your life leaves away. You've got to understand what is eternal inside of you is always greater than what is temporal in your life. No matter how much value we place on our family, we place on our children, every bit of it is His. You've got to learn how to commit those things to God. And Paul said He will keep that which you have committed unto Him. You've got to put it in the hands of God and say, God, you've got to work this out. You've got to trust Him with it. And the thing is, God will never ask you to never ask us to trust Him without giving us a reason to. You know, He said, all things work together for the good. The testing, the trial, the pain, the problems, all these things work together for the good. We have to let God have His way and watch Him work it out. Because His process is perfect despite what we see and what we feel around us. Do you understand that bad things have to cooperate with good things whether they want to or not? The devil has to cooperate with God for God to pour out blessing on you. And the devil doesn't like it, but he has no choice. The devil's pouring it on, and there you are taking hit after hit after hit. And God said, yep, keep it up. Because by the time you're finished, I'm going to bless them so powerfully. All things work together for the good to them that love the Lord and are called according to His purpose. No chastening, Hebrews 12:11 said, for the present seems joyous but grievous. Nevertheless, afterward it yields a peaceable fruit of righteousness. Trials are blessings waiting to be converted into testimonies. Let God convert them. Let God transform them. Because the question is this, Sister Stacy, what kind of testimony do you want? What kind of testimony do you want? What kind of testimony do you have right now? Let's look at this. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 5. By faith, Enoch was taken away so that he did not see death, but was not found because God had taken him, for he had this testimony that he pleased God. Now here's the amazing thing about this. Enoch had a testimony before he ever had the miracle. Mm-hmm. And what was it? He pleased God. Sometimes the greatest testimony is not the miracle, it's the character you show during the test, while you're waiting for the miracle. He pleased God. And do you realize that character has so much to do with your faith? Character has a lot to do with your faith. Listen to Job's character. He was blameless, upright, feared God, and shunned evil. And Job's response to the tragedy had so much to do with the way his faith shaped his character. You know what the key was in all of that? He feared God. He feared God. Amen. That's the greatest thing. Enoch pleased God. These are the traits of people who trust God. They fear Him and they want to please Him. Amen. Oh, I feel the Holy Ghost. My goodness, from the time I started preaching, it has not left. He feared God. Enoch pleased God. They had these testimonies before the trial ever came. Though he slay me, yet will I trust him. Do you know that God reserves the right to slay you? My life is His. My life is not mine. It's His. He reserves the right to slay me. He deserves the right not to heal me. He reserves the right not to deliver or answer any one of my prayers. That's His choosing and that's His right. But here's something that is your right. The right to make up your mind that if He doesn't, I will still trust Him.
That's right.
Are you going to trust Him all the way, or are you just going to trust Him part of the way? Are you going to trust Him when everything's falling just right in place and everything's working out just the way you want it to work out? Or are you going to trust Him when everything in your life is crashing down around you and He's not speaking to you? He's not answering your prayer. He's not moving quick enough. Are you still going to say, God, I trust you. I trust you. Do we trust Him? Of course, the words for trust is waiting, to be patient, to expect it, to have expectancy, and to have hope. David said in Psalm 71, verse 5, he said, "You are my hope, O Lord. You are my trust. You are my hope. You are my trust." Now, what's interesting about this scripture, the word hope in this scripture means you are my cord. And the word security means, the word trust is said backwards, you are my security. He said, God, you're the thing that ties me, that holds me, that binds me. You are my cord and you are my security. But what if He seems to slay you? What if He seems? You don't know what slay means in this scripture. This is mind-boggling. And it's one of the most horrific things to think about. It means to cut off, to kill, or to distance yourself. This is what He said. Though God cuts me off, kills me, or distances Himself from me, yet will I trust Him. I mean, none of us would ever even want to entertain the idea of God cutting you off. What a horrible thought to know that God has distanced Himself from me. But this is what it felt like, and this is what it looked like to Job. I mean, he's physically dying. He's sitting there with this disease in his body, and God is not answering. He's got three of the worst friends in the world sitting around him. Four of them, actually. And the youngest one makes the most sense. And his wife, he even says this about his wife. He says, even my breath is detestable to her. He ain't getting no good morning kiss. The man's really going through it. He is innocent of anything, and he knows it, and that's the problem his friends have with him. He says, listen, God doesn't put this on people if they're good. They couldn't get it. They didn't understand that bad things, yes, happen to good people because God tests us, and God puts us through things because God is looking at the devil saying, you're not going to face him. You're not going to move him. You're not going to change him. His friends didn't get it. Job is sitting there. He's sick in his body. God doesn't answer him. God's not moving. There's nothing taking place. Every day is the same old routine. And in his mind and in his spirit, in his life, he's thinking, God, you're slaying me. You're slowly killing me. And then I said to the Lord, Lord, is there any biblical precedence to this? So then he had me read Isaiah 54, verse 7 and 8, and I thought, oh no. For a small moment I have forsaken you. for a small moment, I have forsaken, for a small moment, I have distanced myself from you. Now here's something really encouraging. A day with the Lord's like 1,000 years, 1,000 years like a day. What is a small moment, Lord? Months? But the story doesn't end there. But with great mercies, I will gather you. For with a little wrath, he said, I hid my face from you. But with everlasting kindness, I will have mercy on you, says the Lord, your Redeemer. Let me tell you something. When you're going through it and he feels a million miles away and you feel like he's killing you instead of saving you, you got to trust in his mercy. Hallelujah. You got to trust in your faith. I know what it's like to go through a week and wonder, God, where are you? Why aren't you answering? Why can't I feel you? That's when you got to live off of your faith and not by what you feel, to know that Psalms 32:10, he that trusts in the Lord, mercy shall compass him about. Sometimes you can't feel that mercy, but you got to understand it's right there no matter what you feel or you don't feel. Because Job never did die. Job never did quit. God's purposes include pain. It includes pressure. And it includes lots of patience. You've got to be patient with God. Amen. You've got to be patient with God.
That's right.
God is not slaying us. He is shaping us. Look at 1 Peter chapter 1 verse 7. First Peter chapter 1 verse 7. Actually verse 6. In this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while, if need be, you have been grieved by various trials. Verse 7. That the genuineness of your faith, being much more precious than gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found to praise, honor, and glory at the revelation of Jesus Christ, whom having not seen, you love. I watch a guy on YouTube. He's a carpenter. He's a Christian. He's a carpenter. He's an older man. And he's also a blacksmith. And if you've ever seen blacksmithing done, it goes through a process. Metal is heated to an extreme. I don't know the exact degree, but it's heated to an extreme degree. And then you take that metal after you pull it out of the fire and you beat it. And you stick it back in the fire and you pull it back out and you hammer it some more. Then you put it back in the fire again, you bring it back out and you shape it and you beat it. Wood's kind of the same way, but a different process. Wood, you cut it, and then you shape it, and then you sand it, and then you nail it, and then you glue it. And I've watched him with that metal, and I thought, man, if that metal had feelings, he'd be really hurting right now, because it looks terrible. But let me tell you this, you're being shaped, and guess what? It hurts. You're being shaped. And all of these things that God does, and the way Peter puts it, and the analogy I just give, all this stuff looks and feels like abuse. It just hurts and you wonder, where are you, Lord? You're being shaped and molded and squeezed here and prodded there and pushed here and shaved here and knocked here and all this stuff's going on. And you're like, God, what in the world is happening? Because you know what God wants more than anything in this world? He wants you and I to be like him. And he won't quit until we do. The process can be painful, and the only way that you can endure it is to trust him. And he's never wrong. And this is the beautiful thing. He makes all things beautiful in his time. The process is painful, but it's beautiful. Hallelujah. It is absolutely beautiful. And hidden among the worthless things of your life is something that he sees as gold. And God's going to extract you. And you've got to stay with a spirit of expectation and say, God, I don't understand what's going on. I don't like how I feel, but I can't wait to see what you've accomplished when this trial and test is over. Hallelujah. And I'm glad the fourth man is in the fire. The fourth man is with me through every test and trial that I go through. Because let me tell you something, if we knew everything that was going to happen, what kind of faith would you have if you knew it all? None. If you knew it, you wouldn't need any faith. Job had no idea that he would live to experience not only life and a blessing, but he would live to experience a double portion blessing. Oh, hallelujah. Because you know what the Bible says? So God gave him twice as much. The reward for trusting God is that God said, I'm going to give you double for your trouble. Hallelujah. I'm glad to know. And the Bible said that God turned the captivity of Job. There's some of you in this building today and some of you watching on YouTube that are wondering, God, how much longer do I have to be in this fire? Well, I'm here to tell you the test is about to turn. Keep trusting God. Don't give up on God now. God said there's a double portion blessing reserved for you. Hang on through the test. Trust me in the trial. Trust me in the hurt. It's starting to turn. There's people in this building right now that God said you're about to see the breakthrough and you're about to see the turn happen. God is turning it around. God is fixing what's been broken in your life. God is making new what's been rusted and decaying. God is turning it around. That's why I can praise him in the test. I can praise him in the trial. I can praise him when I don't understand. That though God slay me, yet will I trust him. Though he slay me, yet will I trust him. Do you trust him today? Oh, hallelujah. Do you trust him? I want to read one more thing to you. Verse 10, James chapter 5, verse 10 and 11. My brethren, take the prophets who spoke in the name of the Lord as an example of suffering and patience. Verse 11, indeed we count them blessed who endure. Have you heard of the perseverance of Job? And listen to this part. First of all, we could all use perseverance, right? Have you heard of the perseverance of Job and seen the end intended by the Lord? God has an intended end. Amen. God has this beautiful picture painted out about your life and about your trial and your test. And God says, you know what? They're going to go through this, but this is how it's going to turn out. And have you seen the end intended by the Lord? How many believe you're going to see the end that God intended? Oh, yeah. It ain't going to be what the devil intends. It ain't going to be what everybody else intends. It's going to be what God intends. This is the outcome. Better than you could dream. Better than you could do it. Better than you could figure it out. Better than anybody else could figure it out. Because who would have thought that at the end of Job's trial, he would have twice as much? I mean, people just started coming, giving him money. Boy, is that what we got to go through? Lord, what does it take for people to do that? People just come and give him money. Just said, hey, God restored his wealth. God restored his health. Trust. So you know what? Don't take matters in your own hands. Put them in God's hands. Trust him. Trust him when it's hurting. Trust him when it doesn't make any sense. Trust him when everything in life just feels like it's wrong. Trust him. Because he believes in you. And that means a lot. Let's stand together. Thank you for being here. Hallelujah. You know, there's a lot of things that I find hard. I do. I find them hard. And many times in my own experiences, I found myself sitting around trying to figure out how to make it right, how to fix it. And I don't want to do that anymore. I don't want my agenda to get in the way of what God is working on. He has an intended end. He has this perfect scenario, perfect thing. You know, I've had people say, I want you to pray about so-and-so, and, you know, and I prayed for him before, and I'm like, I just don't see any way for this to work. I don't see any way for this to happen. And God says, you're praying the wrong way then. He said, you don't have to know. You just ask me to do it. Okay. So I stopped trying to get in the way. You say, God, do it. You know how to do it. But how many of you right now are going through a test? Yeah. Hurts, doesn't it?
Yeah. Before you know.
Yeah. It's a learning curve sometimes, isn't it, to your faith, whatever. There's been moments I thought, well, yeah, God, this is what you want. It feels right. Feels good. Makes sense. Done it. Whew, found out it wasn't. Like, Lord, where did I miss it? Because I. That's where I missed it. I thought it felt right. I thought, oh, God, this must be what you want. Who am I to assume what God wants? I got to trust him. If he's not speaking to you right now, trust him. That's right. If he doesn't tell you to do anything different, trust him. That's right. Just stay on course. Stay on the path. If you need a miracle, trust him. It's all about trust. David said, I'll trust in you at all times. How many of you want to trust him at all times? How many really just feel like, Lord, I trust you with this, but I can't take my hands off that. We have to be hands off everything.
That's right.
Say, God, I trust you. That doesn't mean going, oh, let me one more time. Let me. He'll slap your hands and move. Let me do it. How many want that intended end that God has for you? Yeah, let's come. Those of you in that test today, come. We're going to pray. Let's come. Hallelujah.